Sister Teresa Parkinson tells of a time that she had been working for several months on a poem about consecration. But the poem was too wordy. It would not lend itself to music. In desperation and to break her tension, she picked up a little volume entitled Poems of Dawn. And she opened it to a page containing a poem entitled Beyond the Shadows. The poem seemed to invite one to another time, another world, full of hope and comforting reassurance, just waiting to break upon the earth. Farther on beyond the shadows, falling darkly o'er my way, there is home and rest and shelter where no storms can e'er dismay. She says the music wrote itself. Some years ago, a letter addressed to the Pastoral Bible Institute arrived from a T. Herschel Moreland, who was living in Tennessee. It contained the words and music of a hymn entitled, The High Calling. I did not recognize his name, did not know who he was. In his letter, he said that he had been a serious Bible student for over 60 years. He had written this hymn when he was 94 years old. He was submitting it to us for publication, if we were interested. We had the hymn typeset, and Brother Moreland looked it over carefully, and yes, he found a tiny error in one place. When we had one blank page in one issue of the Herald and no idea how to fill it, we printed this hymn. Brother Moreland was thrilled. Shortly afterward, he died.
Straight.
The author of our next selection reports that there was a day in 1912 when he opened his Bible to John 20, one of his favorite chapters. He says, "As I read that account that day, I seemed to be a part of the scene. I became a silent witness to that dramatic moment in Mary's life when she knelt before the Lord and cried, 'Rabboni.' My hands were resting on the Bible while I stared at the wall. I seemed to be standing at the entrance to a garden, looking down a gently winding path shaded by olive branches. A woman in white, head bowed, hand clasping her throat as if to choke back her sobs, walked slowly into the shadows. It was Mary. She came to the tomb, bent over to look in, hurried away. John appeared, and then Peter, and then they departed. Mary reappeared. She wept. Turning, she saw Jesus standing, and she knelt before him with arms outstretched. Looking into his face, she cried, 'Rabboni.' I awoke in full light, gripping my Bible with muscles tense, nerves vibrating. Under the inspiration of this vision, I wrote as quickly as the words could be formed the poem exactly as it has since appeared. That same evening, I wrote the music."
I come to the garden alone, while the dew is still on the roses, and the voice I hear falling on my ear, the Son of God discloses. And he walks with me, and he talks with me, and he tells me I am his own, and the joy we share as we tarry there, none other has ever known. He speaks, and the sound of his voice is so sweet, the birds hush their singing, and the melody that he gave to me within my heart is ringing. And he walks with me, and he talks with me, and he tells me I am his own, and the joy we share as we tarry there, none other has ever known. I'd stay in the garden with me befalling, but he bids me go through the voice of woe. His voice to me is calling, and he walks with me, and he talks with me, and he tells me joy we share as we tarry there, none other has ever known.
One does not usually think of the fourth volume of Studies in the Scriptures as a source of poetry. Yet, at the end of many of the chapters in our volumes, one does find a poem to fill out that space. That happened on page 384 of volume 4. A better day is coming, a morning promised long, when truth and right with holy might shall overthrow the wrong, when Christ the Lord will listen to every plaintive sigh and stretch his hand o'er sea and land with justice by and by. It's a fine poem, but how would it sound if it were set to music? This is how it sounded to Brother David Duran. In the 1930s, a black gospel singer wrote that he was only 32 and a fairly new husband. One hot August afternoon, he had to go to St. Louis, where he was the featured soloist at a large revival meeting. His wife was in the last month of pregnancy with their first child. The next night, in steaming St. Louis heat, the crowd called on him again and again. And when he finally sat down, a boy ran up with a telegram containing the words, "Your wife just died." He rushed home. He discovered his wife had given birth to a boy. That night, the baby died. He buried his wife and little boy together in the same casket, and he fell apart. He felt God had done him an injustice, and he didn't want to write any more gospel songs. And then one day, a friend took him to a music school in the neighborhood. It was quiet. And as his hands began to touch the keys, something happened. He felt at peace, as though he could reach out and touch God. The melody just fell into place. And he writes, "As the Lord gave me these words and the melody, he also healed my spirit. I learned that when we are in the deepest grief, when we feel the farthest from God, this is when he is closest, when we are most open to his restoring power. And so I go on living for God, willingly, joyfully, until that day comes when he will take me and gently lead me home." Prior to the Reformation, the Psalms were generally sung in Latin to Gregorian chant. In theory, the chant, known as plain song with its elegant simplicity, could be sung by an ordinary congregation with a little training. But over time, the chanting of the Psalms and other hymns tended to be monopolized by the clergy, cantors, and the choirs. As the lay people generally lost their understanding of Latin, much of what was being said was no longer comprehensible to them. Not surprisingly, private devotions were often said in the pews while the Mass was being celebrated at the altar. Now, the Reformer sought to make everything, including the biblical Psalms, more accessible to the people. During the first part of the 16th century, a French court poet turned his hand to versifying the Psalms in a rhymed metrical form, and of course in French. These brilliant texts were set to music, and they became the foundation of the 16th century Genevan Psalter. Comfort ye my people, is a metrical versification of the beginning words of Isaiah chapter 40, which begins, "Comfort ye Comfort ye my people, saith your God. Speak ye comfortably to Jerusalem, and cry unto her that her warfare is accomplished, that her iniquity is pardoned, for she has received of the Lord's hand double for all her sins.
Comfort, comfort ye my people, speak ye peace, thus saith our God. Comfort those who sit in darkness, mourning 'neath their sorrow's load. Speak ye to Jerusalem of the peace that waits for them.
A young 37-year-old mother says that one day, as she was busy with her household tasks, she became so filled with a sense of nearness to the Master that wondering how one could live without him, either in joy or in pain, the words, "I need thee every hour," came into her mind. After writing the lyrics to what became hymn number 119 in our hymnal, she gave them to her pastor. He added the tune and the refrain. This beloved hymn was first published at the National Baptist Sunday School Convention in Cincinnati in 1872. A few years later, after the death of her husband, she wrote, "I did not understand at first why this hymn had touched the great throbbing heart of humanity. It was not until long after, when the shadow of a great loss fell over my way, that I understood something of the comforting power in the words which I had been permitted to give out to others in my hour of sweet serenity and peace." If you were told that our next and final selection of this evening comes from the pen of the 18th century composer George Frederick Handel, you would immediately say to yourself, it must be from Handel's Messiah. It isn't. The first book of Maccabees details the Jewish resistance to the Syrian conquest of Judea in 169 BC. It became the basis for the festival of Hanukkah, or Feast of Lights. Ever aware of a good commercial subject, Handel chose this story of a Maccabean military victory to anchor his 1747 London oratorio series. Praise the Lord.
Amen.